Record.
Okay, so today we will come back to this module, right? We skip this module before the Songkran Festival, Songkran Day, right? So that is about the heap is a topic that also important in C programming or in a computer, because it will be used for keeping the data in the data structure in the form of the binary tree, complete binary tree. So today we will talk about two topics, right? And that is a heap and also Huffman code. We have already skipped the half, we have already talked about the Huffman code before, but today I would like to explain you a bit in different way, right? Okay, so we'll start from the heap. Okay, as I just told you, a heap is a binary tree, right? It's a binary tree. What's happened to my, okay. Heap is a binary tree with the following properties. The first one is it needs to be the complete binary tree. What does mean by complete binary tree? If you could remember, if the binary tree is a tree with two subtrees, right? The maximum is two subtree, but for the complete binary tree, you need to put, okay, the node, right? All to this, the tree, right? But the last low or the last level could be not full binary tree, right? But the level of the tree, but the previous levels of the tree need to be a complete binary tree, right? So this is the concept of the complete binary tree. For shape property, it need to be complete, right? All its levels are full except possibly the last level. Okay, the last level can be not full, right? But okay, where only some rightmost key might be missing. Okay, so this one, the first example is is heap, right? It's a complete binary tree. But this one, right? This node is left, is missing. So this is not a heap. Okay. And parental dominance. The next property of the heap is a parental dominance. The key value of at each node is at least those of its children. It means that the root is the largest, or the root is a maximum contain maximum value. For this example, 10, which is the root of 5 and 7, right? So it is a heap, and 5 is bigger than 4 and 2. 7 is bigger than 1. So this one is a heap. But considering the last one, this one, okay, 10 is greater than 5 and 7 for sure, but 5 is not greater than 6. So in this case, even this one is a shape property that is a complete, this one is a complete binary tree, but it's not a parental dominance. So this one is not heap. It's not a heap. Okay, do you understand this point? So when you are considering the heap, it should be essentially complete and parental dominance. Okay, this is two properties, two important property of the heap, right? That you need to concern about this. We can use array in order to represent the heap, right? Even the heap is a binary tree, but you have known in advance that in order to implement a tree, you can use either array or pointer or linked list or pointer of the binary tree for the binary trees as well, right? So in this case, if you use the array representation for the heap, it is easier and very simple. Okay, so let's see what we have to do with the array representation. So thinking about the left-hand side heap, right, it is represented by a tree, right? Starting from the root node at with the value 10. Right, you can see that for the left-hand side binary tree, you can see that the left, the root is 10, so the index is 1, right? When you consider the index has to be 1, and 8 is the index 2, 7 index 3, 5 index 4, 2 index 5, and so on, right? So why do we have to keep the index like this? Because if you want to change the representation from the binary tree into the array, so you have to concern carefully about the index of the array. For this example, you can see that if you change the binary tree into the right-hand side, which is the array representation, you can have the index value running from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, until 10. And the first index that you will use will be the index 1. You can see that from this example, the index 1 will store the value 10, index 2 store value 8, index 3 store value 7. It seems like it is in the descending order or in the order from maximum to minimum. It seems to be like that. But actually it's not. If you can see from this example, you can see that 3 is 7, index 4 is 5, index 5 is 2, index 6 is 1, but come back to index 7 is 6, it could be 6. Because it's not necessary to be in the ascending order, the descending order, right? Because you have to separate the array into two sides according to the left subtree and right subtree. Okay, so from the array representation, you can see that this is the this one is a right subtree, a left subtree. This is one is a right subtree. This left subtree will be stored in this part of array, right? Okay, but the index of the array will be like this, right? Array size n plus one elements with position zero unused. This will be the heap representation. And for a specific node J, right, node J, left child index is 2J, and right child index is 2J plus 1. From this example, if we considering the root node, index 1, so the left child node of the root will be 2 multiplied by 1, that is 2. This is correct. The 8 is at the index 2. And for the right subtree or the right node, right, it will be 2 multiplied by 1 plus 1 is 3. And 3, so 7. Okay, this is the way of the array representation of the binary tree on the left-hand side. Left-hand side binary tree. This one. Okay, so, and if you want to know about the, okay, this is it. The left subtree of it is next two will be 2 multiplied by 2, that is 4. Okay, 5 is here. This is a left node of it. And how about the right node of it? This will be here. Do you understand the point? And about the 7, six three index three, so it will go to six and six plus one, that is seven. How about four? Four multiplied by two is eight. It will be eight and nine. Okay, this is a way of the array representation, right? If you want to calculate for the index of the left and right trees, left and right childs or children of a particular node, J. Okay, you can multiply by two and multiply by two plus one and plus one. Okay, if you want to calculate back to its parent, a node's parent, so you can just simply use the function j divided by two and use for function. Okay, that is to calculate the parent index. Finally, non-leaf node. Non-leaf parental node at location 1, 2, floor n divided by two, right? If you want to calculate for the parental node, right? At location. So this is another representation of the array, right? If we have 1, 2, 3, 4 levels, okay. I'm sorry, this one is written in Thai because I also use this slide for the Lecture program students. You will study about this concept in the next semester, in the next term, in the course CPE 212 algorithm design. Okay. Okay, this is another example of the array implementation. Suppose we have the tree like this, right? This is unbalanced tree, right? A, Y, and R, right? A will be in this index, right? Y in here. And if there is no right tree, right child here, so this storage will be empty. Okay. The same way, if you have just only right subtree, right, you can see that there are many empty storage. Okay. But if the heap is full, complete binary tree, is a complete binary tree, right? So you can see that in the storage array, there are full of the value in the array. Okay. So now we know the concept of the heap, right? And we will use heap for some particular reason, right? But first of all, if you want to make use of the heap, you need to construct the heap first. So in order to perform the heap construction, first of all, you have to initialize a complete binary tree from the given key, the given keys, right? So the concept, we use the heapify concept. Okay, so what will we do for the heapify the tree? Heapify is to construct a tree. First of all, you have to start with the last or rightmost parental node, right? We exchange key K with its children if the parental dominance does not hold. And then we will check the parental dominance for the new position of K. Okay, and repeat until the key K goes to the right location. Okay, the heapify is a concept of how to insert the new node into the heap, but the heap has a concept that the root node of all node will be the maximum number. So you need to do the concept of the heapify that I'm going to show you in a minute. And then we'll continue with other parental notes up to the root and end. So we come up with the heap. So in order to show this one, so maybe I have to share the screen. Okay, for heap construction, suppose we have the heap like this, or initialization, we have the like this, but this one is not the heap. So what you have to do is, because two, two is not the maximum number. So in this case, you can see that it is located at the last element in the heap, but it is greater than 7. So this one is not stable. So this heap has to be modified. So we have to swap 8 and 7, 7 and 8. So we will get this 3. Now we consider 8, right? We consider 8 and 2. So 2 is less than both 8 and 9. But in this case, we have to select 9 and promote it to be the root. But we have to consider 9 with the 6 and 5 as well. But 9 is greater than 6 and both 6 and 5. So we will swap it. Now we have to consider 2. 9 and 8. 9 is greater than 2, so we have to swap 9 with 2. But this one is not stable as well, because 2 is not greater than both 5 and 6 as the concept or the property of the heap. So you need to swap 2 with the highest element among 6 and 5, that is 6. So we have to swap 6 and 2 here. So this is the concept of heapify, right? We have to traverse along the tree until the property of the heap is met. Okay, you have known that the concept or the features of the heap is that it must be the complete binary tree, and the second property is it is parental dominance. Okay, so do you understand this one? I'm sorry when I try to convert this. Can you hear this slide number 9? Suhani, what do you mean? It's not necessary that five will be on the right or on the left of the tree or the subtree, because the concept of the heap is just the root has to be the value of the root or the root of the parental node must be greater than the child node. That is only the concept of the heap. As I just told you, that heap, you don't have to, it doesn't have to be the descending order or ascending order. Okay. Because in the PDF file, right, that I sent to you, this page is missing. I mean, some of the information is missing. So I copy this information into your in the group, right? So you can just simply copy from that, or you try to write the remaining part in your slide. Mm-hmm. Okay, if you finish this, I will go back to my... So what is the computational time or the computational complexity of this function, heapify? If you can consider it carefully, the heapify function, the complexity is big O log N according to the complete binary tree, right? Complete binary tree, right? We have just only log n level, log n plus one levels, right? So the number of maximum is the number of swaps, the number of swap will be just only in the big O log n. But because we have make use of the concept of the binary tree, and then we have to go traverse not more than the level, number of the level of the tree, and number of the level of the tree will be, for the complete binary tree, the maximum number is log n. Okay, so this is the complexity of the heapify. And we also have the function or the algorithm heap bottom up and heapify, right? So you can write a program in order to implement this heapify, right? I think it's not that difficult for you to implement in C program. Okay. And the next concept that I'm going to talk today is if you want to insert a new key or a new node into the heap, what shall we do? If you want to insert a new key, we have to insert to the last leaf node. Okay, so in this case, suppose you insert 10 into this heap. So you need to insert this one, this node in the last node, the rightmost node of the tree. And then you perform heapify. Right. Repeat swap the new key to its parent until the parental dominance is satisfied. first of all, you have to consider that this one is cheap already, and then 10 is greater than 8, right? So we will swap 8 and 10, and then 9 is the root is less than 10, so we have to swap 10 and 9. Now, it is already heap. Yes, it is. So for the inserting key, right, we need to use the top-down heap construction. Right, so this way, inserting a key on a heap, right, big O is still log n as well. Where n is the number of the nodes in the tree. If we want to delete a key from a heap, it's very simple as well, right? Suppose we want to delete k, key k in the last heap. No, in this example, we want to delete 9, key to delete. 9 is the root, it's the most difficult one. So what you have to do is you can just, the first step that you have to do is you have to swap the key to delete with the key, the last key. In this example, 1 is the last key and 9 is the key to delete. So we swap 1 to here and 9 will be here. And then we can delete 9 from the tree. But now this one is not a heap, right? Because it's not a heap. So you have to perform heapify the tree by shifting k down the tree, right? 1, comparing with 8 and 6, right? 8 is greater than 1, so you swap 8 to here and then 1 to here. And then 1 cannot be here, right? So you have to swap 1 with what? 1 with 5, right? So 5 will be swapped to here and 1 will be shifted down to this place. And this one will be a binary tree with the concept of the parental dominance. So it is a heap. Very easy, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, when I was studying the heap concept, right, when I was in the university, I think this one is very easy. I like heap because it's very simple, okay? And also we can use the heap for heap sort, right? The concept of the heap sort, you can also use the heap construction, right? So I'm not going into detail about this. I just press address here because you are going to study about the heap sort in the next semester or the next term in the subject algorithm design. So I'm not going to explain about this, right? And this will not be in the examination as well for the heap sort, but I would like to show you the application of heap. Right, we can also have the heap sort with the concept of big O, n log n, like merge sort and quick sort, right? So you can also use a heap sort in order to sort using binary tree, okay? And that's all. Now, do you have any question about the heap? Heap construction. Okay, I think it's quite easy and simple, right? So if you don't have any question, I will. What is a key k? It's just the variable k. I don't know why key k. Or key k is the last leaf node. And 9 is a key to delete, just in this example, okay? Okay, So let's come back to the part of the Huffman code, right? Why do we have to use a Huffman code? It started from the concept of ASCII code in the past, but if you want to implement a character, you may need to use the ASCII character concept. ASCII is an abbreviation from the American Standard Code in International Interchange or something, right? This is the full name of the ASCII code. And by that time, we use only 7-bit fixed length code for the ASCII. Nowadays, we don't use ASCII. We use Unicode actually, because ASCII is not enough, right? We use the Unicode with 16 bits. By that time, right, we use only 7-bit, right? We have another 1-bit is a parity check bit, right? We use to check for the transmission, character transmission. We need the last 1-bit to check for the parity check bit. And okay, in order to do that, we may have to normally when we use an ASCII code, we have the fixed length code 7 bits, I've told you. But sometimes we may want to compress the file size, or we want to instead of use the fixed length code, we can also use the smaller size of the fixed code by using the Huffman code, or we can say the encoding. Okay. We can do it by using the fixed prefix free code like Huffman code. For this example, if we have a symbol A, right, we have a code with 01 instead of the 4 bits, right? We have maximum 4 bits here, right? Or we can use, we don't want to use the 7 bits, right? We want to encode with the prefix free code. For this example, A is 01, B is 11, C is 000, D is 01. What does it mean by prefix free codes? Prefix free codes mean there is no code word that is a prefix of another code word. Once again, prefix free code means no code word is a prefix of another code word. What does that mean? Okay, when I am considering C, 000, there is no code word 00 before it. Just only 01 and 11. If we want to use or to check for F, this is 1000. There is no prefix 10 for other, okay, for other three, right? There is only 000, 001, 101. I'm going to tell it why we need no code word that is a prefix of another code word. Okay, for this example, okay, Huffman tree is named that by David Huffman in 1952. Okay, so in the previous example, okay, this is it's different one. So if you want to check for the code of A is 00, and B is 10, E is 111, right? C is 0, 010, 010. This is a Huffman tree. Okay, you may have a question that how can we construct the Huffman tree, right? So this is a Huffman tree algorithm. Huffman tree algorithm is a greedy algorithm, greedy strategy. But we use greedy strategy to construct a Huffman tree of n symbol. So starting from n single node trees and combine them to a single tree, we can generate short and long code word according to the high and low frequency. If you know that a symbol has high frequency means the number of occurrences is high. The possible number of occurrences is high. For this example, okay, this one is not a good example, but in this example, we suppose that A has a frequency of occurrence is 0.25, B 0.21. So in this way, we need to encode or give the code for A, longer or shorter. If A has a high frequency, we need to encode A to be shorter characters, shorter length or higher length or longer length. Can you answer my question? You can type into the chat box. If A has a possibility to occur more than the others, so A should be short or A should be long. If you want to compress your data to make your data shorter, A must be encoded shorter. Am I right? Shorter. Okay. Why? Why? Because if there is a high possibility of A and we want to keep or to store the data very short, so you need to
ให้กิน
ลงไปละของถามเขาว่าไม่ก
ินหนูไม่ตอบเลย
ทุกข์กับดิโอเค so you need to calculate for the binary T for half algorithm here. Okay, we have known that A has a frequency 0.25, right? And B is 0.21 and so on, right? For this example, you need to sort this one. Sort this one. And then the step of calculating for the, to encode this one, to encode this example is you need to combine two smallest frequency. Once you combine this one together into a subtree, right? So you plus dot 0.07 and 0.06, so you can get 0.13, and then you can get this subtree. Okay, and then this one 0.13 is greater than 0.08, so we have to resort this again. Okay, and now and then we have to combine this one because these two are the smallest, so we combine this together so you can get 0.22, right? And when we got 0.22, so we have to move this to this place, right? Have to sort, and then we have to combine this into the new one, that is 3.32 and 0.32 will be moved to here. Okay, 0.32 will be moved to here, right? And then now we have 2.2 here. And we have to sort, right? 2.2 and 2.1, you combine to 14. And then when we sort this one and this one, have to combine this together. So you can have okay, this one, and then combine this together. So you can get this one with the occurrence one. And then you can see that A, we have the shorter code 0 and 1. Am I right? And then B, B we have 1, 1. And the lower possibility or the frequency, you have the 1, 0, 0, 0, right? The longer code, right? So what is the best case compression ratio for Huffman code? This is an algorithm in order to calculate for the Huffman code according to the frequency of the character. Okay, note on Huffman code, if you sort the initial tree from a smallest to larger weight, a different Huffman code will be generated. Okay. It depends on the sorting algorithm. If you sort from the smallest to largest and largest to smallest, the result will be different. The same Huffman code tree must be used for both encoding and decoding. But if you select which one, you have to use the same algorithm in order to decode that Huffman code. Okay, in order to okay, you can try to do this exercise in class exercise, right? Suppose we have A, B, C, D, and high and underscore, right? Can you generate the Huffman code for this input? And then what is the average number of bit per symbol? Okay, you can try. If you finish this, you can tell me. Okay, in this example, right, have you finished that? You need, first of all, you need to sort according to their frequency, right? And you have known that 0.1 and 0.15 is the smallest two. So you combine these together, so you can get 0.25, right? And 0.5 is you have to sort it this again. So you combine this into okay, combine this and this together, and then combine C and D together. So you can get C and D with 0.4, and this one is 0.6, and then you can have 1.0. So you can come up with the result like this. Okay, is this your result? So from this, you have to show the Kaufman code, right? A is 1, 1, B is 1, 0, 0, C is 0, 0, D is 0, 1, and underscore is 1, 0, 1. Okay, and we want to find the average number of bit per symbol in this code. So how can we find this one? Suppose you want to store the word that, D-A-D, right? You need to encode as D is 0, 1, A is 1, 1, and D is 0, 1. Okay, and that add is, will be encode like this. Okay, so in order to find the average number of bit per symbol in this code, right? So how can we calculate for this? So you need to, okay, to sum of the product of the frequency with the length of the code word. The length here is 2 multiplied by 0.35 and 3 multiplied by 0.1, which is a frequency. And 2 is the length of code C, right? Multiplied by 0.2 and 2 multiplied by 0.2 and so on. So you can come up with this number 2.25, which is the average number of bit per symbol in this code. Okay, if in the examination I ask you the average number of the bit per symbol in this code, you need to calculate by using this formula. Okay, this is the solution for the Huffman algorithm. Okay, because last time we have already talked about the Huffman algorithm, but I think I explained you not clear about how can we develop or generate the Huffman code and finding the result of the code word. And then I didn't tell you about how to compute the average number of bits per symbol in this code. So I summarize it here again. Okay, question. Okay, that's all for today's class, right? And next week, I think the next Tuesday is a holiday, right? The next Tuesday is a holiday, right? So we have no class on mm-hmm. You mean, yes, I mean Wednesday, sorry. When the next Wednesday we have no class. Okay, we have no class for next Wednesday. So it is the coronation day. So, Vanessa, okay. You'll be happy, right? We have no class, but we still have to see each other on Tuesday. So today, please type 5 and then you can leave. Today I have no more class today. So you can take your rest or sleep, right? Okay. Thank you very much. Have a good day. Don't forget to finish the lab yesterday, okay? If you don't understand, you can post your question in the group. Okay, see you next week. Bye bye.
อาจารย์ครับ
ถามว่า
ตัวโปรเจกต์อะครับอาจารย์จะสั่งตอนวีคไหนล่ะครับ
วีคหน้าค่ะวีคหน้าในห้องแล็บแล็บน่าจะหมดแล้วค่ะแล็บน่าจะไม่มีแล้วจริงๆควรจะประกาศอาทิตย์นี้เนาะใช่ไหมคุณลืมโทษทีเดี๋ยวรอไปอาทิตย์หน้าแล้วกันรู้สึกโปรเจกต์จะเกี่ยวกับ Halfman Code นี่แหละค่ะพี่วีคิดละนั่นคือทำไมครูมาอธิบาย Halfman Code อีกทีหนึ่ง The project will be about the Halfman Code right We'll talk about the project next lab next TuesdayThank you for asking. ขอบคุณที่ถามค่ะ Can we have a scope on the project? พี่วีคิดโปรเจกต์อยู่นะแต่โปรเจกต์ไม่น่าใหญ่อะค่ะอยากจับกลุ่มเองใช่ไหม
โปรเจกต์จะเป็นเหมือนตอน AVL 3ไหมครับ
โปรเจกต์จะเป็นแบบ AVL 3ไหมน่าจะให้เขียนโปรแกรมแล้วก็จบแล้วมั้งคะไม่น่าจะเขียนเป็นคำไม่น่าจะทำเป็นวิดีโอมั้งเอ๊ะแต่บางทีก็ต้องอธิบายเนาะใช่ไหมถ้ามีเวลาน่าจะยังมีเวลาอยู่อะค่ะเนาะน่าจะแบบมีอธิบายในห้องแบบเนี้ยเดี๋ยวต้องคุยกับพี่วีอีกทีนึงเหมือนกันค่ะวิชานี้เป็นครั้งแรกของครูกับพี่วีเหมือนกันก็มันจะขุกขักนิดนึงเนาะ สิริว่าคุณครูยังไม่แน่ใจโปรเจกต์สโคปเลยค่ะให้พี่วีเขาเป็นคนคิดสโคปอยู่ครูเลยยังไม่รู้เนาะเดี๋ยวยังไงถามเข้าไปในกลุ่มดีไหมเดี๋ยวเผื่อพี่วีเขาจะได้ตอบได้นะคะขออภัยเนาะ I'm so sorry อือหือ But the project is not the big one